My name is Sergei, and today I'd like to talk about Maven build optimizations. If you have a huge Maven project and you're not satisfied with your build performance, perhaps you're considering options to migrate to Gradle. And indeed, Gradle has a lot of advantages, especially in performance area. But before doing this and making this decision, I recommend you to understand how Maven works under the hood, how to locate bottlenecks of your build and to address them. Actually, surprisingly, Maven has a lot of opportunities to optimize your build. We'll talk about compilation mostly, not tests, because of the small time slot. So let's start with something simple. I hope your engineers of your organization are already using fancy Apple Silicon laptops. You just need to ensure which actual GVM are they using, because Rosetta gives overhead over executions. There is simple command mvn-v, and you can just ensure if the proper GVM is used or x86, meaning the Rosetta mode. You can even automate this validation either with a simple plugin or shell script, or use existing one. If you don't want to control your engineers, and this will just break your break the build to avoid performance overhead. Note that Rosetta emulation consume 40% of CPU and even more, so it's pretty big overhead. Also, it makes sense to upgrade to the latest GDK, because it not only gives fresh and new language features, but actually each new major release of the GDK makes significant performance optimizations also for the compiler. Also, the vendor makes sense. For example, from my experience, Oracle JavaC was not the fastest. So I recommend you to try different ones and compare. You can be surprised by the results. If you're using Kotlin in your projects, it makes sense to upgrade the second version of Kotlin. JetBrains made huge work rewriting the compiler. And don't be confused with the second generation of versions. It's only about the compiler, but not the runtime compatibility. Just do it in three steps. First, you need to upgrade to 1.9 and release it. Then you need to upgrade version of the Kotlin to 2.0, specifying language version 1.9. Don't be confused again. It's not the GDK version, but it just means use the first version of the compiler. And then switch to the language version the second to use the K2. Even if you are mixing Java and Kotlin sources in the same codebase, you will notice this performance boost, because it's pretty good. Historically, Maven never had build cache support out of the box, but recently Apache released its own caching solution that can cover some basic scenarios, and I've seen open source projects like JTA adopting it. Just beware that it has some pitfalls. For example, with improper configuration, it can lead to caching incomplete or even empty test suites results and other things. But again, it can give you some boost and deserves your attention. Another build caching solution that I generally prefer over Apache is Develocity. You could also note it's Gradle Enterprise extension from Maven. It's pretty easy to integrate. Just added two extensions XML, and almost that's it. It will not only provide local build cache and potentially remote build cache, but also will give you build scans, which can be a source for insights, and we will use those build scans to explain some things about performance. So let's in my example, I'm building a native project, so I just added the Develocity extension to it. And you can see that results are pretty visible out Without the caching, the compilation takes about 2 minutes, so the caching is disabled. And with caching, it's almost 45% faster. So other insight that we can have from this build scan is pretty low CPU utilization during the build time. It means that even if you have a pretty powerful laptop, it's not utilizing its CPU cores as much as possible. So let's try to build it in parallel. So there is a parameter called dash T. You can specify the number of threads you want to use, or you can also multiply it by the number of your CPU cores. By default, it's always one. But also I'd like to mention, if you want this parameter to be applied always by default, so your engineers don't need to specify it on the command line, you can add .mvn maven.config file and just add it to your Git repository. And your engineer will automatically apply this to their executions. For sure, that can be a problem with test execution that need the support of parallel running. If you're using fixed network ports, it can be a problem. But still, let's see what happens with native projects. And execution time is much better now. This is with disabled caching. It's 1 minute, so it's twice faster than default build. But also, the build scan gives us insight what actually happens during the build. And we can see that at some intervals of time, the parallelization is quite good. But in some intervals, especially in the beginning, you can see that only one thread is actually doing the work. And this is actually a way how to find the bottlenecks in your build. So you can just visualize timeline and see modules that have issues. We will now discuss actually how why it happens. In the meanwhile, there is one more tool that deserves your attention. It's called MVND, Maven Daemon. And you can recognize pretty similar user interface experience as a Gradle daemon. But I'm talking about it because it can give us insights about build bottlenecks. So if you make, for example, a recording of the execution and then check carefully different moments of the build, you can see that at some moments you have very good parallelization, like on the first screenshot. But at some moment you can see that only one module built at a time. And this is the way, again, how you can find bottlenecks. Why it makes sense here? Because unfortunately, not all companies can use build scans by Gradle because of their security policies. And this is just another way how to obtain this. So briefly, the key factor of proper parallelization is modularization. If you have a single module application, you don't have room of possible options here. But if you have multi-modal application, actually, this is the way how it can be parallelized. And we will talk about this now. This is the main key takeaway from this presentation. So I'd like to explain how so-called Maven Reactor works. Maven Reactor is an engine that schedules multi-module execution. And for each module of your build, it first resolves all upstream dependencies like jar libraries or other modules. And when they all are resolved, it starts sequentially execute goals of your module, like generate sources, compile main, compile test, surefire test, integration test, install, package, install, deploy, and only after all goals are executed, our module becomes available for downstream dependencies who depend on us. Even if the other modules depend on us in test scope or runtime scope, it doesn't make sense because of how it works out of the box. And this is quite different with how Gradle schedules the build graph, much more efficient. We have such limitation. But actually, it can give us some insights about how we can optimize our Maven builds. For example, Maven has a dependency analysis plugin by default, and can give us some advices which dependencies are redundant, and we can remove them. Why it can help us? If we reduce the number of dependencies of our module, it means that it can be scheduled earlier in the pipeline. If it's scheduled earlier, the build of it finished earlier, and it becomes available for other modules. So in general, the timeline on the timelines, everything shifts left. It means that it's executed faster. Another approach is that we can separate modules, extracting some subset of classes. What advantage do we have here? Usually, if you can extract, for example, a package of some business logic, such package will have a significantly smaller a subset of dependencies. And what we can see here, we can achieve better parallelization because we can now build like two modules instead of one, and potentially much earlier. And the modules itself are smaller, and they become available for our downstream dependencies earlier. So the amount of code on those two diagrams is more or less the same, but you can see that execution timeline is now much more compact and faster. You just need to find your bottlenecks of your build. Usually it's just several huge modules, but eventually you can have a much better parallelization. Another more complicated case is if you are using dependency injection framework like Spring, you can extract so-called API part like interfaces of your services, exceptions, enums, whatever. Again, those modules will have smaller subset of upstream dependencies. And also, consumers of your module most probably don't need all the implementation details. And normally, they should not like care of it. And what we see here again, all the timeline shifts left. So a module becomes available as built for our downstream dependencies earlier, and in general, all the timelines shifts left, and the build is more performant and has better parallelization. So, talking about modularization, it's not only gives you better domain and ownership boundaries, but also has performance boost. And what also makes sense, if we're talking about build caching, your build cache can be more efficient with more granular models. This also makes a lot of sense. If you're using code generation, this can be quite convenient, but I recommend to extract it to external libraries, especially if we're talking about Protobuf, Avro, or Juke, which consume some static files like SQL or Proto and generate sources, because there is a huge disadvantage here. You generate the model classes and then compile them. But then in IntelliJ IDEA, if you run, for example, a test, IDEA will not recognize this as incremental compilation because it's built by Maven and will compile it again. If you extract it to libraries, you can fully shift to incremental compilation in IntelliJ, and it can be extremely faster in general than it was. If you were making a library, it could make much sense to deploy sources jar with it, but in most cases, just stop deploying additional artifacts of your build, like sources, test sources, Java doc, and test jar, because it consumes time, consumes space on your registries, and nobody usually loads those artifacts ever. If you're using test jar dependency, I strongly recommend you to stop doing this. It can be a look convenient, but actually it brings some issues like in IDE integrations, and also it will not give you opportunity to run builds with Maven test skip true flag. This also a way how you can optimize a pipeline. You can make two parallel pipelines. First, just skipping all tests and creating distributions, which are then used in deployments. And the second, you can compile and execute tests and verification what makes sense here? Normally, you should always ensure that all validations are successful and only then to deploy. And absolutely most cases, you will do it like this. But unfortunately, there are very rare situations. For example, if the security vulnerability was found or your service is just not working and there's no options to roll back, you can only move forward. You need some way to deploy faster. And if you have faster pipelines like this, you can do it in minutes. In your CI/CD environments, I recommend you to use persistent build agents. Persistent means reusable more than once because you can save time loading dependencies from your registries, also to reuse local build caches. But don't make it too long-living because it can raise other problems. Adyen by default builds everything in single thread, but also supports parallel compilation. You can find those in compiler settings. Just enable it and don't forget to increase memory. That can boost your builds in IntelliJ as well. You can have a lot of additional actions like verifications, producing additional artifacts, etc. But if you don't really need it, in most cases, it makes sense to hide them under profiles. In your CI/CD pipelines, you can execute them where it's really needed. Or engineers, if there are just few percent of engineers that really need some additional artifacts or modules, whatever, can enable them explicitly. But by default, your engineers will be able to execute some plain command like mvn clean install, like skip test, and their builds will be fast by default. Finally, for sure, it could make sense to migrate to Gradle to use all the advantages of it. Just keep in mind that it's not only work of your developer productivity team. You need to do it atomically, just your pipelines and release cycle. But also, you need to teach your engineers to use a new tooling and you need to make a strong, a complicated decision. So in many cases, it could make sense to stay in Maven, but eventually it's up to you. So in summary, check your GDK and versions, stop doing redundant operations, use cache and modularize. And after all, I would like to say that Maven is not that bad and it deserves, I think, attention, and you can make your builds great again. So, slides available if you want, and the plugin that mentioned that will break Rosetta executions. That's it.